Blaney and Sadler making up row one. Cindric Elliott in row two.
See that gap between the one car and the 23 car of Chase Elliott. That is not what they need. They need to be almost hitting each other to stay close to that inside line. Now they're hooked up.
Not legally hooked
up. They're
just
bumping.
They're just bumping. They can't hook bumpers. They can't stay connected or they'll get a black flag. But you see the shove. Now Elliott Sadler with a big run, but he has no help behind him.
Oh, as Elliott gets to that right rear quarter panel, he's there. He got that right rear quarter panel and pulled the 22 of Blaney back to him. Now he's hoping the 23 can get to him to push him in front of the lead. Almost cleared him.
And right back, here comes Blaney with the same thing, side drafting him, trying to pull him back. But here comes the 23. Chase Elliott now trying to bump that one up front. And now Elliott out in front.
Hang a left, Elliott. If I'm Chase Elliott right now, I'm sorry, if I'm Elliott Sadler, I'm hanging a left. I am leaving the guy that just helped me. I'm going to go to whatever lane's the fastest. I know he helped me get to the lead, but right now it's about me winning the race.
It's hard to decide, though, because both lanes look great. There's a lot of cars forming on the outside line. It's got the tighter, you know, the tighter bumper-to-bumper action, and that's where the energy is going to be coming from, Jeff. That's what the spotter's trying to tell. But he goes to the bottom here as the bottom line starts to form. It's going to keep changing, and that information from the spotter is really critical right now to give Elliott the information he needs to be able to pull up in front of the line that has the energy, because he needs that energy. They're going to shove him forward. He'll jump in front of the 23 here, get a push. You see him push his car away. He also stalls that 23. That gives him a chance to get back down the bottom, maybe get a push from the inside line.
And you said got a push. They never touched. Is there that invisible air bumper that we've been seeing?
We always called it the beach ball effect. Imagine a giant beach ball in between the cars. And when the 22, if they, you know, there is a chance when they kind of pop that beach ball and you get to the bumper. But if that doesn't happen, you can't get shoved away by the car behind you. That beach ball stays intact.
That's the goal of building a good speedway car. We talk about how well it pulls up to the car. You want a car that can drive through that beach ball and get all the way to their bumper, because that way you can pull out the pass before you help the car in front of you.
People think we're crazy, but that's exactly what it feels like. It feels like a giant beach ball in between you and the car behind you, and you want that to stay there. And that's what Elliott needs to be moving in front of both lines to get the shove and get the momentum, keep the momentum in his car, so that they don't break that beach ball or break that bubble and get to his bumper. But it looks like that with movement like that.
Oh, he got to the left rear quarter panel.
Blaney able to get to the inside of him, and now Blaney trying to take the lead back. But you saw the one, Elliott Sadler, trying to do the side drafting once again to take the air and put it on that spoiler of the 22 to slow him down. But now that inside line forming up solid again. They're side by side for the lead. That time, the gap between one and two, 18 one-thousandths of a second.
Elliott Sadler, big run right there. You saw what he did.
Oh, around goes the 60. Austin Cindric wrecking in front of the crowd. Daniel Hemric's caught up. Tyler Reddick, Cindric, barrel rolls.
See when you're done, Cobblin.
Lands back on his wheels.
Okay, Matt Tim trying to make a lot happen.
Joey Gase in the 35, sitting right up against the 60 now. Safety crews will get out to the attention of the 60, the 35. See Tyler Reddick, a lot of damage to that race car. We saw Cindric getting sideways as he was coming through the tri-oval. Joey Gase in the 35 looked like he was trying to drive away from that wreck. Sure enough, he does. And now the safety crew gets to Austin Cindric. A wild ride for the 19-year-old. See a lot more damage. That right front of Joey Gase as he's been able to pull away from this wreck. No rear deck lid on the 60. No rear bumper cover. Barrel rolling through one was Cindric. February winner, Tyler Reddick. A lot of damage to that car. Matt Tiff also involved. Great sign here. Austin Cindric climbing out of the 60.
Such a promising night. Was doing a great job. This place will break your heart. Think you'll have a shot to win this race, and then you find yourself flipping through the corner. That's Daytona. So you see right here, they enter the corner. It's up the racetrack a little bit. Matt Tiff's going to try to drive in there to get to his inside, and they just got together. 60 of Austin Cindric just wasn't on the very bottom of the racetrack. Opened up a little bit of hole that Matt Tiff was, you thought was there, and then you see right here the contact with Reddick. Started Cindric's flipping. That's very unusual to see a car flip that late after initial impact. So here we go above.
Well, Jeff, you knew it was just a matter of time. It was trying to get really bunched up too wide, and Matt Tiff thought it's under 20 to go. He had to make a lane. You see that tumble, as you mentioned, really rough for the 60 car, but basically Matt Tiff thought it was time to try to make it three wide. And we've seen that before, Dale, out of the tri-oval. If that inside road doesn't protect the double yellow line, that's a place that people get runs. But that was late into the corner for Matt Tiff to look underneath the 60.
That is a late move, and it's difficult to be able to, you know, for the spotter to give that information to the 60 that he's got a car underneath him. But there was room there. There was room to go, and Matt decided that that was the move he wanted to make.
You'll see right there, there's a little bit of a hole. It looks like he has room to go to the bottom. And when he went to go, it just closed up. And, you know, we always like to point a finger and say, this guy messed up or that guy messed up. And many times it's just racing. I mean, it's people going for a spot.
Pretty wide. Up in front of the car, you push it.
This is the front seat that I wonder, guys, as we ride along with Custer. You see a little contact there, but I think.
Inside.
He doesn't know where the 21's going to go. So, I mean, all day you ride in line back there. Here you go. This is the helmet cam. What a great shot.
As a driver there, you just get up high and try hope that they don't come up the track into you. If you're way behind the wreck, you try to slow down without locking down the front tires and sliding into the crash. Wild action under red flag. We'll be right back.
Really had to follow that kind of feel or tempo in the race. We had really three cautions before then, two were sustained brakes, but all of a sudden now they pile up in turn one.
Well, with 18 laps to go, things are starting to get a tad rambunctious, so that what we saw in turn going into turn one is what we saw similarly coming out of turn four, where it's basically an accordion-style crash. It just so happens that Austin Cindric is the one that got punted going into the corner. He was the pinball that kicked off all of the bouncing and careening off each other, and then ultimately flipping down the back and landing on all four wheels. We'll get a word from Austin as he makes his way into the care center here shortly.
Yeah, and when you look at the box score from this race, you won't see Austin Cedric's name showing up as having led a lap.
But he has been in the top five virtually all night long.
18 laps to go, and a red flag has come out here at Daytona after somewhat the big one that just took place. Matt Tift involved in it. Let's listen into his radio.
Sorry, 60 went up so high, and it's trying to go under, and he's trying to come back down again.
Well, so, I mean, that's basically how we saw it, right? Is the 60 was up, and the two decided to make a lane. So take a minute right here before we roll it. This is the 60 of Austin Cindric. Fair to say he is a lane and a half off the yellow line. In my opinion, I'm not a race car driver, but I expect him to be more defensive if he doesn't want to leave that lane open. So it's a late move by the two of Matt Tifdale, but there's more than enough room for a car until they get to corner entry.
Yeah, there's enough room for the car, and that's also a very difficult place to spot. The spotter is seeing basically the same view we had, the back of the race cars. He can't really tell whether he can clear his driver, the number 60, or whether, you know, there's room for him or not enough room for him to come down. Obviously, there wasn't. And so, and it's such a late move on the transition into turn one that even if he does get that information to his driver, it's too late. So kind of a perfect storm there to create that kind of crash. But they also, these drivers will often run side mirrors on the A post of the driver's
which
door.
Which sees down the left side.
Which allows them to see. He would be able, if he has that side mirror, he would be able to see the number two car in that position and know that maybe I shouldn't turn down into the corner. So, you know, there's a lot of variables at play there, but there's plenty of racetrack here for Tiff and anyone else to make that move, and that's a fair move.
So one thing we got to think about, and Steve used the phrase play defense. Well, remember this yellow line right here. Remember what the rule is. The rule is you cannot pass below the yellow line. So if you're the 60 car of Cindric, you use that yellow line. You use that like a wall. If you can get yourself against that, nobody can drive underneath you. So this late in the race, when you leave that lane open, it incites someone to try to go into it. And it's Daytona. I mean, it's not like Austin Cindric did something major wrong or Matt Tift did something major wrong. It's these little small things that happen and cause wrecks at Daytona when it's 18 to go. This wreck doesn't happen when it's 100 to go, but when it's 18 to go, people start driving into holes that weren't there early in the race.
Yeah, Jeff, and that's what's going to happen as laps wind down. But Dale, you and I had this conversation earlier today. You're explaining to some of the TV guys about these accidents. Take us in the cockpit. What's it like when you get one of these big wrecks and next thing you know, you're upside down?
Well, this crash right here, I mean, those are jarring hits. As this car's bouncing and tumbling down the racetrack, that you're banging around in there. And that's very difficult. In the faster flips, where the car's flipping quickly down the straightaway, you're kind of the force is actually the inertia's shoving you into the seat. So it's hard to tell when you're upside down and when you're not. Really, you can only tell visually by seeing grass and the ground and all those things coming at you. It almost feels like somebody rolls a prop wall of grass up against the door of the car when you're flipping over on the driver's side. At a high rate of speed, the inertia shoves you down into the seat. I flipped enough to know this, obviously, but it's a weird, weird feeling. There's some weightlessness, quietness. Then all hell breaks loose when cars are smashing into you, and hopefully, you know, you're not getting hit while you're upside down. You kind of get nervous about things like that. That could be a potentially bad situation. But this was pretty uneventful, and we're glad he was able to get out.
Hey, you know what's great about that interview? I learned something, which meant I never flipped. I didn't know what it was like, so he was teaching me something.
Oh, my God. Well, wouldn't have never flipped. I was talking to Denny Hamlin earlier today. He's never flipped a car. I mean, I thought everybody
that's
flipped.
That's a goal, man.
Right?
You beat the tires on the ground.
Well, I hate, from a crew chief, I hate during those wrecks, the radio sometimes comes unplugged. That's the worst feeling because I'm watching on TV, and I get on the radio, hey, man, you okay? The silence. But when you finally come to a stop, like, what is the next thing? Is it WinterNet? Is it on, like what do you do as a race car driver after an impact like that?
Well, yeah, I think you just make a good personal physical check that everything's still there and everything is okay. And you just realize that you've done something that not a lot of people have done, and that's flip a stock car at over 180 miles an hour. And it's even though it's not a badge of honor, it's something that you can say that you've experienced and not a lot of people have. And you definitely don't want to do it too often. Once you've done it once, that's enough.
That's the badge. You don't need more.
One time's good.
I would say no times would actually be better. So that's what I'm shooting for. Over 18 cars involved in this big one here at Daytona. A long list of names that have a lot of damage to a lot of these race cars. Xfinity Series back under the lights next week, next Friday, at Kentucky Speedway. The race coverage begins at 8 p.m. Eastern on NBCSN. And we've already seen what being under the lights can do to this series. Crazy wreck just taking place. Elliott Sadler, three.